Yes. I just got a text about the party.
Oh, you know I'm going to be there. Everything's good to go. We're ready to go. It's coming back. We got Battleground. We still got Ultimate Glory coming up. It's going to be amazing. We're going to have a great show for Ultimate Glory. Party man, you know I'm going to be there. It's a huge party. I'll be there. In a minute.
Damn it. Gotta get this thing rewinded. 2 minutes more likely.
So, what brings you here?
Well, I'm kind of excited. I'm excited for the comeback.
I know everybody is, right? Yes. Everybody's excited for the comeback. I'm excited, you're excited.
I'm excited to have Daniel Mars on the palm of my hands and be able to go.
Well, you two been having issues.
Well, I've got issues, but he, let's just say, his high school following, where he got bullied all the time and was kicked in the pants all the time, it's following him in COH. He seems to be that little nerd that just seems to think that he is smarter than what he really is. He's one of those guys that says an awkward joke and he laughs at it to himself while everyone just kind of looks at it anyway. Anyways.
Well, I mean, what can you do?
Well, there's been something I've been meaning to ask you.
Shoot.
I've never quite understood this. I don't know if you heard. I've been exclusive with you for quite some time.
You have? Hell since yeah. Day one?
Since day one. I've been with you since day one. I was given a contract by Ryan Paul Jones to join his Fed, and I took him up on that offer. That doesn't mean I'm leaving COH. I can't leave the place that I started my name from. But there is something interesting that's just always stuck with me.
Yeah.
Okay.
What has interested you, well, Mr. Atkins?
Here's the thing. You've had your Batemans. You've had your Nates.
Yeah.
You've had your Alexes. You've had your Patriots. You've had your Goonies. You've had quite a plethora of talent. Some have made it to the top, some have not. Some have been here for a long time, some have not. But I'm going to be quite frank with you. I'm not exactly the most innocent person. See?
No, you're not.
This is not a white hat, ladies and gentlemen. In case you're unaware, it's Slytherin, Harry Potter, everybody. Yeah, I think everybody would know what school I'm a part of. But, I just got out of Wizard World. Listen, I'm a despicable human being. I ain't gonna front. Nothing would entertain me more than to just low blow you right now and you fall to your knees and I just walk away. But I ain't gonna do that. Because I kinda need answers. I just need to know, of all this time that I've tortured your roster, all this time that I've made the living hell out of lives, why the hell did you not fire me when you had ample opportunities?
Oh, I would've. But you see, every person you pissed off, they came in my office. You probably don't know about this. They came in my office telling me, I want to fight this guy. Do not fire him. Do not suspend him. Do not even, hell, you can fine him, sure. But don't suspend him. Don't fire him. Keep him. Because I want to get my hands on him. And whatever you want to do to him, I will do to him. I will make him bleed. I will make him suffer. I will make him scream for his life. I heard that from Zane LaFontaine. I heard that from the Alex Enterprise. And I've especially heard that from Daniel Mars. Plus, I like you.
I like you too, but sometimes...
But you see, it's more like a love-hate thing.
Oh, better.
I love to hate you. You're kind of like an ex-girlfriend. For some reason, something about, you know, I would still fuck my ex-girlfriend, but, you know, with no intention on ever loving her. You know what, it kind of makes me sick. Yeah.
That's it? That's and all you could come up with?
That's it.
Kind of disappointed by
and like
that.
You said, you've been loyal to me. You haven't ran off to a nation. You didn't just take the title and leave, you stayed, champion or not. And I talked to Ryan Paul Jones. We discussed your contract. And you can do both. Go to El Dorado Championship Wrestling and still be here in COH. You're a star, man. I can't hold on to you forever. I gotta let my babies go. They gotta spread their wings and fly. And damn it, they're gonna... Oh, that answers your question.
Can we hug it out, man?
Hug it out? Why not?
But there's one thing I have to do. You see, you called me an ex-girlfriend. Well, you just got friend-zoned. Nothing personal.
We're back! And it's not a dinosaur story. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the Doc. We are back here at COH. And I'm joined tonight by a new commentary partner, Mr. Ryan, how are you doing today?
I'm doing great, Doc. It is great to be here calling my first ever COH event. Been following the brand for a very, very long time, and what about what we just saw here before we went on the air? Immaculacy laying out Mr. Sparks himself with a super kick.
Fair.
Well, I guess anything can be expected when you're talking about Immaculacy. And speaking of
Immaculacy, just keeps getting more and more unstable. I don't think he's reacting to his relative normality very well. I know he hates it when I call him normal, but it was predictable. As soon as he said, I want to hug it out, I knew Mr. Sparks was going to go down like a blonde date. I knew it.
Yeah, he got dropped quickly there. He got dropped like a bad habit, if you will. But Ultimate Nitro is out here. Ultimate Nitro is on quite the roll coming off the Survival of the Fittest here.
You know, ever since Anniversary, people have been just coming up to me asking the weirdest of things. They've been asking me, how does it feel to know that you, the Ultimate One, Nitro, are in the main event of Battleground Side of Ultimate Glory? How does it feel? How does it feel to know that you finally made it? How does it feel to know that you're finally in that top spot that you always wanted? To tell you the truth, it's been a long time coming. You wanna know how long I've been waiting for this? You wanna know how long I've been in this industry? You wanna know how long I've been here? 10 years. I've been waiting on this opportunity for 10 damn years. You wanna know how long it took for me to get to this position? Here in COH, it took me 3 years. You wanna know how long it took me in general? You wanna know how long it took for me to get to this position? It took me 10 damn years of my life. That's a long time for someone like me. That is over half of my life getting to this position in life. So, when people come up and ask me, oh, how does it feel? It feels like I've just been rolling through the goddamn Sahara Desert without just a search for a goddamn drink of water. That's how it feels. It feels like I've been frozen in ice all my life, and I'm only now just getting thawed out. It feels like I've been walking through the 8 circles of hell, and now I'm finally getting to that ladder to heaven. And all I need to do now is just beat Goody. All I need to do is just beat Goody at Ultimate Glory. And that 10 years will just be worth it. All of that effort, all of that time spent, every single damn moment will have been worth it. It'll all be worth it. And you wonder why it'll all be worth it? Because I will be Battleground's second ever global champion. I will end the reign of terror that is Goonies World Championship reign. I will finally become a world champion after 10 damn years of waiting. All I need to do now is win one match. And I'll be damned if I let anybody stop me from getting to that point.
Well, Nitro with some great points there, especially about potentially ending the Goonies terror streak, because it has been, in my opinion, just that. Because of what I maintain, him winning the championship in an odd and shady way. Speaking of odd and shady, this man right here, Kenyon Phoenix, coming out to the ring to address the elephant.
Yeah, it's hard to really argue against someone like Nitro right now. Like I said, the streak that Nitro's been on, one of the most popular faces right now in just the entire industry, as you said. Just to think that he's been here for 10 years, but Kenyon Phoenix, on the other hand, a man who just of questionable character of late, making just a complete 180 in the direction of who he is as a character, and just seemingly turning his back on everything that COH stands for.
And, you know, I know Goonie still prides himself on being in the eye of the fans, but to me, he turned his back when he went for the pin after he looked Jay Krack directly in his eyes after he did what he did.
Well, you have to think going in that Goonie and Brandon Wolfe as a match, it was one of those timeless matches. It doesn't matter how many times we've seen it, that people want to see it, and yeah, something like that happens, it's going to be questionable.
You did it. You won the big one. You won survival of the fittest. And you're out here celebrating. I understand that I probably might not have been the first person you would have thought of to come out here and congratulate you. But that's somewhat of a mistake. Because I shouldn't be congratulating you. You see, Nitro, that match was a fluke. I should have won that match. The apron was a bit slippery. And I don't know where you pushed me off and I fell. But you know what, Nitro, it doesn't matter. Because you see, why should the biggest match at Ultimate Glory have to be given to somebody who wins a battle royal of all things? Come on. The global title deserves a rightful contender. That's why I'm out here and I'm congratulating you on winning Survival of the Fittest, but I think tonight you should do the right thing and give me, because I was the last person eliminated, a one-on-one match tonight here in the main event of Battleground. And the winner would go on to Ultimate Glory to fight the Goonie. What do you say?
Do you really take me for that much of an idiot? You don't think I know what kind of game you're trying to play me for? You really don't think I know exactly what you're trying to do? Oh, you're making up the excuse of, oh, the apron was slippery. Oh, I should be the one going to Ultimate Glory. Let me put it to you like this, Kenyon. Weren't you the one that just recently had a global championship opportunity against the Goonie? And what did you do with that? You squandered it. Meanwhile, on that same show, I beat Stefan Guerrero after a goddamn year of hell I experienced with him. And you wonder how many people thought my match was better than that bullshit you had? So many people thought that was so much better worth of this high. So many people watched that CPV just to watch our match. But you wonder how many people gave a crap about you fighting for the global title? Nobody. And they know that because nobody wants to see somebody like you face off against the Goody, because they know you don't have it. You had your chance, Kenyon. And I'm sorry. I'm sorry that you lost. I'm sorry I had to be the one to eliminate you. And I'm sorry that for some reason you feel like you're entitled to this championship opportunity. You're entitled to try and have another chance. But you had your chance at Anniversary. And you squandered it. And I'm not going to be the one to be faulted for the blame on this.
Why am I not surprised? Of course you would say this. Of course you would deny me a match. Because you don't think I deserve it and I've had chances and time after time and yada 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 and the same old, same old. But come on, Nitro. Listen to me. We can make history tonight. Give me the match that I deserve. Or are you too much of a pussy? You know what, actually, that makes me remember something. You know, it's about time, you see. Why not? I have a free forum. All of you people have bashed me for my nickname. Of all things, is that the best you people can come up with is going after my nickname? You know what's funny about my nickname? It's a tribute. It's a gimmick, you people. But you know what's not a gimmick is, you see, you bash my nickname for being gay and for being faggoty. But you know what the funny thing is? You all cheer this man, and he's the biggest a gay I've ever seen in my life, because this true homosexual is your big baby face, but you all give him praise, but you bash me for a nickname. Hypocritical, isn't it? Oh, ooh, I brought up something that I shouldn't have, didn't I? You know what? I don't care anymore, because I'm fed up with it. Nitro, I want you to give me what I deserve. Now give me my match tonight here on Battleground. One-on-one, we make history, and the winner goes on, and it will be me. Now Nitro, say yes, you're getting on my last nerve.
You know what, Kenyon? For all intents and purposes, I should give you that championship. I should give you an opportunity to have my shot. I should give you that chance. I should give you an opportunity just so I can slap your fucking face right out of goddamn orbit with what you said. But you wonder why I'm not gonna do it? Because that would be wasting energy on somebody who isn't goddamn worth my time. You want to talk about me being gay? You want to talk about the fact that, yeah. And you want to, no. Let's go off the script a little bit here. Can you want to make mention of my sexuality just so you can even get an opportunity against me? That is a low fucking blow. And you, of all people, should know that. You want to go ahead and use my sexuality to go ahead and try and intimidate me? To try and get your opportunity? To try and get under my skin? Well, guess what? It's not going to work. It may work with other people, it may work with people like the Goonie, it may work with other people like Inaccuracy, it may even work with, like, anybody else. But I've been dealing with this my whole life. And I'm not about to let somebody like you take away what I have earned just because they have insulted my sexuality. Good night, Kenyon.
So, wow, a lot to take in there. Kenyon Phoenix attacking the sexuality of the Ultimate One. I'm not sure if that's the route you want to go, but nonetheless, the Ultimate One walking away. Wait a second.
You turn around, boy. You listen to me. Come back here. No, you do not walk away from me. Nitro, give me my match. You come back, you bitch. Come back here, you know, I can keep going in the book. Get back here, you faggot. Get back here, you motherfucker. Get back in this goddamn fucking ring. Give me my match.
Nitro, don't do it. I mean, he doesn't deserve it.
Yeah. Phoenix has clearly lost his mind. There's got to be some kind of repercussions for coming out here and insulting another man's sexuality like this. Doc, you think that the Kenyan has got the Nitro here? You think Nitro's gonna cave and buckle under these circumstances, though?
I hope not, because this is just a fact.
This message is addressed to Chef Johnny Thunder. Now, Chef Thunder, I did say to you I would be backstage on the last Battleground. Now, the reason I interfered in after your match with Barney Green, it wasn't because you cheated to beat Barney Green and hit him with that egg beater. It's because after the match, because even after you'd beaten him and Barney Green was hurt outside the ring, you still whacked him with that egg beater, and I thought to myself, enough is enough, and that's why I came out and I jumped off that top rope and I hit you with that sunset flip. But somehow you managed to arm drag me down and you whacked me with the egg beater on my forehead and my ribs multiple times, and I think I somehow blacked out and I woke up backstage after that, though, because I don't remember. I think someone must have carried me to the backstage area. And that's why I'm here to issue a challenge for a match, whether it's a future Battleground or Ultimate Glory or a future CPV. If we're still on Battleground after Ultimate Glory. And I know that if I face you and I beat you, it will be an awesome party. And I will crack open either a bottle or a can of beer. But this is a warning as well. If we do face in the ring and you even attempt to use that egg beater, I will not hesitate to grab a steel chair as an equaliser and whack you with that steel chair, and that will be an even more and better party. So, Chef Johnny Thunder, I am issuing the challenge to you for a match. Either a Battleground, even Ultimate Glory, or a future CPV, the challenge is on and the party is on.
We need to take a second here, because a lot has happened, but not a lot of time for us to react. In no way, shape, equalizer prepared to steal kick. So just throwing that out there. Some other serious things of note. Kenyan Phoenix, absolutely, even by my standards, taking a low road. Try to get him to change his mind. Ryan, what do you think? I don't think it's going to work. It could. I think it's cheap. I think he's been saying that he deserves a shot, because, as he said, he still lost the match. He even admitted that, and the match was for the number one contendership. By definition, losing that match,
I have to completely agree with you here, Doc. Everything Kenyan Phoenix brought to the table in this debate, if you will, completely unsound. First of all, he admitted that even if the apron was slippery, as he says, that he slipped off the apron and fell, whether or not it was Nitro or not. Secondly, Nitro, his goal was to eliminate Phoenix from the match in the first place. Then he goes on to completely discredit the fact that a battle royal warrants the title shot now that Ultimate Nitro has. Let's just put everything in perspective here. Nitro has everything to lose should he take that offer. I guess you could call it an offer. Phoenix has everything to gain. Nitro has to really go back and think this through.
Yeah, there's not a whole lot of upside for the Ultimate one. I mean, it's just like the Marty McFly problem from Back to the Future. All he's got to do is walk away and no one will think any less of him. And that's the truth, because they're nothing but empty words coming from the guy in COH who frankly probably doesn't realize Harley Quinn is a made-up fictional character. Let's be honest, his apparel probably does not warrant that fact, the way he talks. He's obsessed with Harley Quinn. Have you ever been in his locker room, for God's sakes? It's disturbing. So, he clearly doesn't have stuff right in his head. As Levi McIntire and Gavin Fletcher are in the ring for this next contest. Like I said, still have to react to a few things, though. So, you know, Kenyon Phoenix, clearly not all there. Clearly trying to get to the Ultimate One, who is the Ultimate One, who is right as well, saying. And it has taken him a long time to get where he is, as Thunder's Children come out now to in this contest. I'm sorry, that's right. He gave me permission to go ahead and call them the House of Hypocrites. I apologize. I do not want to besmirch the name of Johnny Thunder, who is just, for all intents and purposes, the best athlete in COH. You know, call me crazy here. But getting back to the matter at hand here, when you look at what they are saying and what is going back and forth, the back and forth between the Ultimate One and Kenyon Phoenix, the Ultimate One, there's just no upside, there's only downside. It's taken him 10 years to get where he is. He does not need to risk this just because someone comes out and attacks his sexuality in an unwarranted manner.
Yeah, it makes you wonder, is pride and honor, are those things tangible here? Are they worth it for him to put this on the line? I mean, obviously that's what Phoenix is trying to get at here. He's trying to get right down to the pride of Ultimate Nitro and take that away from him to try to bait him into this dilemma that we're at here. But again, hopefully Nitro, he can go back and cool down a little bit. So it's like Tyler Richards with a forearm there, stunning Levi McIntire and allowing Calvin Barksdale to take advantage.
Calvin Barksdale showing some impressive strength right there with a back suplex to Levi McIntire. The other thing we have to react to is we had very little bit of time, and then we can catch up to current events. The meeting between Immaculacy and Travis Sparks. Travis Sparks talking to Party Man, which I have to dock him cool points for, because why on earth would you ever want to talk to that prick? I thought, you know, just for talking to Party Man alone, Immaculacy was warranted in kicking the living hell out of Travis Sparks. But, you know, Travis Sparks did wind up going down like a prom date at the hands of Immaculacy because of saying, you know, exclusivity. He's always been there for him. They had a love-hate relationship. Some wanker by the name of Ryan Paul Jones has asked him for has signed him to a contract with some low-key off the beaten path fed down in the boondocks of St. Louis or wherever it is, El Dorado. It doesn't matter. It's not even worth mentioning on COH television.
Well, Doc, I'm going to have to stop you there, because if maybe you missed the memo, AJ Hawks from El Dorado Championship Wrestling is facing Immaculacy in what I'm calling a blockbuster match, a must-see match for Call All-Stars 9 coming up. So maybe you're still a little unaware of what El Dorado Championship Wrestling brings to the table, but Immaculacy is going to have his hands full with the Madman Technician. It's going to be a great match. So
I'm telling you what, anybody who comes from anything called ECW never amounted to anything in the history of wrestling.
Well, that's an opinion. We'll leave it at that. Anyway, Calvin Barksdale here making a two count on Gavin Fletcher. It's like action starting to pick up here as we got all four men in the ring and the referee's losing control here on Battleground.
But, so that pretty much brings us up. I'm sure we'll harken back on those two things As time goes on in this broadcast, as more things are brought to light, especially as the Ultimate One mulls over the decision. I'm guessing he's going to mull it over because he did, in fact, come back into the ring.
Well, and you know, as it stands, Kenny Phoenix, he wants the match tonight. He wants the main event tonight. Yeah. So we have to have a decision before the end of the broadcast here.
So we'll focus on this match now a little bit as we try to digest and let the audience digest. Hail Fuhrer Trump, by the way. Hail Fuhrer Trump. Build that wall, because America. So that brings us up to speed now.
Gavin Fletcher there with a nice slide through Hurricane Rana and trying to make a cover here for his team on Calvin Barks a lot, and oh, that was a very close two count there.
It is two count. Ooh. So it's weird getting back into the saddle. It's kind of almost like, you know, you fell off some training wheels. House of Hypocrites, however, looks like they, you know, they're right back on it. I mean, they're right back on that bicycle.
Absolutely. Barks a lot here. He's got quite a bit of experience in the COH ring. Tyler Richards is new to the dance, as well as Gavin Fletcher here. Oh, wow, what a neck breaker that was. The shades of Brandon Wolfe with that one.
Here's a cover. The Wolfman. Two count. We'll undoubtedly be hearing from him. Be some references made, at least to Brandon Wolfe, I'm sure, later in this broadcast. As the issue at hand with him and Jay Krack.
Absolutely. A very, very poignant growing issue between those two. Gavin Fletcher with some power now. We've seen he's been moving around pretty quickly in this match, but a huge spinning sidewalk slam there. Barks a lot. Looks like he might be tag out, as Levi McIntire must have read my mind. He's clearing the ring there. Tyler Richards and trying to pick up the pace here for he and Fletcher.
Don't give Levi McIntire that much credit. He did not read your mind. His mind is so empty. It's like if you whispered in his ear, it would come out the other end as an echo. That's how empty his mind is. Read your mind. He can't read an ant's mind. Are you kidding me?
Well, I was about to say, Barks out there with some more power offense, and McIntire definitely felt the brunt of it, taking his time to get back up after that near fall. Pretty solid opening tag team match here tonight on Battleground. Following, like you said, all of the drama and all of the personal issues that we've seen aired out here at the beginning of this broadcast.
Oh. Seriously, 24 minutes to get to our first contest. That's something you'd see in something like ECW or WWE.
I would say maybe some other feds, but maybe not ECW so much. We're all about the action over where I come from.
El Dorado Championship.
McIntyre there with a big clothesline. Just like a meathead clothesline. Maybe they're going to put away Barks a lot here, sizing them up.
Letting his tank, letting his freaking arm do the dirty work for him.
Yeah,
there they are, right there. The winner, Levi McIntyre. In the Brit kit. Take a look. Tyler Richards jumping off the rope. Connecting right there. Connecting right here, both of them, the House of Hypocrites.
Yeah, some impressive offense early from the House of Hypocrites. A lot of tandem work here. But in the end, it was this powerful package pile driver from McIntyre.
That's all he's good for, just the muscle. That's the only thing he's around for.
Well, it did look like Fletcher did quite a bit of the work in this match. You know, I will say that. Fletcher was very impressive here, and McIntyre just kind of coming up to the cleanup job to follow there at the end.
Mama done told me you're something to know. Leave out McIntyre. Get out of here with that.
COH Battleground, episode 77. Guys, it's been a while since COH Battleground's been on air. We've been on a hiatus due to a big pay-per-view that COH and CCL had, which I really don't care, called Funarchist.
which I really didn't care about. So, tonight, I'm in action. It don't matter who I face in the middle of that ring. You see, Aether, I still have your number. I still am going to destroy you. Because, see, Aether, don't forget, I don't forget you. But, you see, it doesn't matter what general manager, whoever it is, that's going to put me in action against. All I'm going to be is dangerous. All I'm going to do is go in that ring, be dangerous, hit someone with the Meyer bomb. 1, 2, 3. My hand raised in victory as I win my match. So, COH, I'll see you next time. Because I think my match is about to start right now. And this match has been moved to the next match. I'm totally kidding. We're back here. And we just heard from Michael Miner. It looks like it was a cheap mobile device from last year. That smartphone was so 2016.
Well, speaking of personal issues, Michael Miner seems to have personal issues aplenty here. And with a good friend of mine in Aether, I wouldn't be picking on Aether. He's a little guy, but he packs quite a punch. And Michael Miner's going to find out if he keeps pushing Aether around.
I like Aether. I think he's a solid athlete. I think he's got a bright future in business. And he's a real kind of knock-em-out, go-right-for kind of guy. He doesn't let his mouth overload his right check that his body can't catch like some people who may or may not be in the room.
Well, we're going to see, I guess, what Michael Miner, a.k.a. Dangerous Michael Miner, is all about here tonight. He's ready to take on Raymond Dudley, the fan favorite here. Of course, I guess anytime you're in the ring here with Michael Miner, you've got to be a fan favorite, right, Doc?
Just about. But who cares what the fans think? I know I certainly don't. I've been down that road before thinking, liking and caring what the fans think, and it just doesn't work out. Because, frankly, I see things in a broader spectrum than what some of these simpletons do.
So, what I'm getting out of this is that, you agree with some of the things that Michael Miner would have to say then, because I see him as an individual that doesn't quite care for the fans' perspective either.
I agree with anybody who does not base their every women call on the fans. Now, there are some things that you do. Now, in the course of my career, as I'm sure you are aware, I have played both the villain and the hero. And any time I do both, it is not to appease the fans. It is because, to quote Batman, I do what is necessary. I do not care if it pleases your Royal Highness or if it doesn't please your Royal Highness. Those are my kind of superstars. The superstars that know eventually them and the fans are going to cross paths. And they may not always like where their career is going to go after that. That's my kind of superstar, the one who's not naive enough to know that them and the fans are always going to be best friends. Because I'm here to tell you, that is nothing but showing naivete.
Oh, see, well, it's good to know that you're a vigilante of sorts in the industry, Doc. I appreciate
vigilante of call.
I appreciate the insight there. Michael Miner looked like he thought he had Dudley put away with that torture rack, and Dudley with a counter into a DDT there. A little bit of offense finally from Dudley late into this match.
Raymond Dudley, by the way, is no one's fan favorite. Just throwing that out there.
Michael Miner hitting a huge powerbomb here off the ropes, and that's it.
Like I said, right there. scrub-a-dub-dub. That was a scrub-a-dub-dub match.
Well, another tough break here for Raymond Dudley. Young man who just can't seem quite to put his finger on what it takes to achieve victory here. And, wow, Miner just trying to drive him through the middle of the mat there with that powerbomb.
Michael Miner, dangerous Michael Miner, showing with that powerbomb, as you said, why he is the dangerous one.
Wait a second, there's Aether there coming in from behind.
How does he sneak up on Michael Miner? He's dressed in bright colors.
I think Michael Miner was still relishing this quick disposal of Raymond Dudley, but that's what I said.
As anyone should. If I beat Raymond Dudley, it should be a cause for celebration. Are you kidding me with that? Don't celebrate for beating Raymond Dudley. An ant could do that. It's so easy a caveman could do it.
Michael Miner connected with a forearm there, and he's running for the hills. The referee getting in the way here of Aether. I think he's just going to celebrate as he walks away. When a man walks away from a fight, it celebrates. Aether had his number here, and he's just going to head to the back of Aether instead of Dudley.
I still don't think Aether had his number. I maintain it's impossible to sneak up on somebody while you're wearing bright colors.
Well, I guess we'll leave that debate for another day.
And I am here making a very special cake. That's right, cake. What you eat at parties, what you eat at funerals, because funerals are better than parties. Currently, I just applied the olive oil on the cake. Now, while I'm waiting, party man, what's his name? Luke Evans? The reason I've been attacking you, because you do not belong in this company when I'm here, because I am world famous chef. I defeated Bunny Goon for the first time in a long time, and, you know, it felt good to kick the ass of Bunny Goon. You attacked me, though, party man, and I'm not good with the English too much. But you are a piece of shit. It's complete. I don't swear. Chefs don't swear, but today I swear. Now, Chef Yanni Thunder hits you with his egg beater. You know, egg beater. Like that egg beater, you know, Jenny egg beater. So, the egg beater made you bleed and sweat and cry. Imagine what Yanni Thunder is. Fist will be on your face. You say you want me? Well, tonight you got me. I'll be there. Be there, party man. If there's one thing I hate, it's a bad party. And you are a bad party. You're the man who brings Cheetos to a party. Do not I bring? Let me show you. The cake is done. The cake is done. That, my friends, is a fidget spinner cake. How creative. A fidget spinner cake. I can even spin the cake, just like I'm going to spin you into thousands of pieces, you piece of party poop. You bring Cheetos to party, I bring fidget spinner steak. And I will see you tonight, party man.
Just absolutely brilliant. Johnny Thunder, Chef Johnny Thunder, has invented the gold
coast. Party Man was some big talk earlier, but you know, I gotta say, I think I'd rather have a steel chair wrapped around my head than to have Chef Johnny Thunder spin me into thousands of pieces.
And Brutus the Barber Beefcake makes his way down here. The most annoying superstar in COH Histoire. Johnny Thunder will know what that means. Because it's French. Stop dancing!
Well, this is your favorite part of his entrance, isn't it, Doc? You know the...
Shut up. I liked you up until now. ridiculous to sit here and be subjected to this. There are children starving in Africa, and we're watching this. Pathetic. Johnny Thunder needs to go make them all food. They don't starve. Pitiful.
The battleground's not a party until the party man arrives, and he's here scheduled for action tonight.
Yes! Yes! Ladies and gentlemen, please rise for your resident hero, Chef Johnny Thunder.
Doc, would it be a fair guess here to say that the party man has bitten off more than he can chew?
Hold on, I will answer that. As you're supposed to stand when the pledge is being played, when the anthem is being played, I am standing as Johnny Thunder is making his way out here to pledge my allegiance to Johnny Thunder. Stand up. Yes. Johnny Thunder, everyone. Showing the fans the respect that they deserve with that nice bow. Yes. Awesome. What did you ask me?
I was just wondering, you think the party man, has he bitten off more than he can chew here, taking on the chef himself tonight? He gets served up a clothesline there by Chef Thunder.
Absolutely. Party man has bitten off way more than he can chew. This match will be brief. This match will be victorious for Johnny Thunder. And hopefully, if I get my way, Johnny Thunder will crush the soul of the party man.
He tried to crush him there. A huge splash from the ropes there. And party man able to get out. There was a two count. Things are already trending south here for the party man.
And you know what? Frankly, I'm appalled that Travis Clark signed this match, because Johnny Thunder has more important things to do than deal with the likes of the party man. He should be out inventing the world's next big delicious dessert, or the next big cuisine. This man is a culinary genius. His book is selling like hotcakes, which he will tell you how to make for $99 on Etsy. Okay? That's how I got it. That's how everyone got it. And it's just phenomenal. So, you know, I'm appalled with Travis Sparks for signing this match.
You know, I actually looked for that book at the table tonight, at the merch table, when I came in, and I was surprised it was actually sold out. They told me they were going to have to restock, so I was unable to pick up a copy myself here tonight. I was going to grab one for the missus. I thought she would like a new Chef Thunder cookbook, but...
Are you saying your missus doesn't know how to cook without a cookbook?
I just thought maybe she'd like some new recipes to spice up the kitchen a little bit.
Nice save. See, I've had other commentary partners before that would trip up and they would fall on your face. You, however, you, this guy. Yeah, good job.
Thunder here again trying to put away the party man, Luke Evans, and Evans able to get out. Those two counts are getting closer and closer, though. The party man's really going to have to get on his game if he wants to recover this match and try to save it himself.
I don't understand why the party man wears a mullet. Because it's a party in the, what is it, business in the front and party in the back? Is he saying that he likes the party in his back?
That's, I guess, kind of what he's getting at here. I was kind of questioning the bow tie myself. I wouldn't really wrestle in a bow tie. I feel like that would be... It's something that your opponent might try to grab a hold of and use against you, you know, choke you out with it or something, but it's each their own.
That's why he's a Brutus the Barber Beefcake ripoff, because that's what he used to do.
Well, we get to the party man trying to fly here, taking it up to the danger zone.
Oh my gosh!
A leg drop from the top, trying to guillotine Chef Johnny Thunder. Two count. Oh.
He got How did he do that? Well, they say a blind squirrel finds a nut every now and then. Party Man found a really big nut right there when he landed right on Johnny Thunder.
Thought you were going to hold your breath there for a second. Doc Thunder looked like he might have been in a little bit of trouble, but he's already recovered, and there's another big clothesline to the Party Man.
Johnny Thunder will not, I'm telling you, he is just a nice guy because he started from humble beginnings. He's just letting Luke Evans get in a couple shots here and there just so he doesn't completely embarrass him.
Wait a minute! And just as you say that, the Party Man with the roll-up on Chef Johnny Thunder here. It's an upset tonight on Battleground.
What just happened? What?
I'm in disbelief here.
The Party Man won a match?
He just didn't win a match. He won the match. Getting some vengeance here.
Johnny Thunder does not compute. All right, take it away, Brian. I can't. My mood is shook.
We're going to have to look back here at what happened. We were in the middle of a conversation there, and Luke Evans with the O'Connor roll, it appeared. I was not expecting. Here it is right here. Used all the weight and momentum there of Thunder to catch him off guard, and it's two, and there's the three count, and that's it.
From that angle right there, it was clear that he was pulling the tights of Johnny Thunder.
It looked like he had his hands in a legal position there. I'm sure we'll hear more on this soon, though. You got to think that Chef Thunder's not going to let him live this one down as he breaks it down here. Some celebratory dancing. And
I'm so shook. That was not basic.
This night continues to get more and more. Wait, oh!
Yes! Yes, Johnny Thunder knew that he had a handful of tights. Yes. Put that cheating like the dog he is, Thunder. Yes. Show you how to cheat in this match.
Well, Party Man was trying to get his win on there with that celebration and.
Let's go, Thunder.
Chef Thunder has none of it here.
Let's go, Thunder. Let's go, Thunder. See, now they're chanting, "Let's go Thunder." I got them chanting. Look, they still love me even though I don't love them.
Not the way that Party Man expected his night to end here after a big victory.
If that fight wasn't clear enough, then let me just tell you. I'm all in. I want to face you, Jay, at Ultimate Glory 5 for your Internet Championship so I can take that title away from you and win my first championship in COH. But while you were issuing this challenge to me, you were ranting about me. Well, if you want to shoot, let's shoot. But let me give you a heads up. Unlike you, I don't shoot blanks. I hit the target every single time. I mean, what did you say that was original? What did you say that only Jay Krack has said about Brandon Wolfe? We were a part of crappy tag teams, I'll admit. We had to hold on only our end, but our partner's end. And we just got so tired of it. We just went separate from them. And we did. And when we did that, we benefited ourselves. We made somebodies out of ourselves. And what our partners do became nothing but nobodies. Well, what else did you say that was original? Nothing. Other than something about your grandmother that I didn't give two pisses about. I mean, other than that, it was just copy and paste of what everyone said about me over the past year. I don't deserve anything. I haven't earned anything. I have been handed opportunities. Wow, that's a bold statement. I've been handed opportunities. Yes, I have, and you have as well. Everyone's been handed opportunities. But it's what you do with them. It's what makes them. Doesn't matter if it's win, lose, draw, with any opportunity I have been handed or earned, I have left with a good impression. Where the champion and the people that run the place didn't regret a guy like me having that opportunity. by handing things, Jay. You're a prime example as well. You were handed to be a part of that match in the Elimination Chamber for the Internet Championship, the title you won. I mean, what did you do before that? You got your ass kicked by Fisk in Tokyo, Japan. And that night, I was handed a global championship match that I didn't want, but I was forced to be a part of it. And what happened by the end of that match, I was close to winning that title when I had Daniel Mars interrupt the match, ruining it for everybody, screwing me out of the opportunities. You know, I could talk about the opportunities I've had from top to bottom, but I can also tell you every opportunity I've been screwed out of. Daniel was mad I had something just like you, but he was mad that I had a briefcase. You're mad I got opportunities. I mean, talk about opportunities. How did I get the opportunity on anniversary? You know, the one that you screwed me out of? Did I walk up to the champion and ask and beg for a match? I want a shot. I want a chance at the title. Please give me the match. I'm not that pathetic of a competitor. I mean, I'm not going to do what Blackos did and ask for a match. I mean, look what happened to him. First time he failed. Second time he upped the ante and he still failed. And after that failure, he became nothing more than your bitch. I mean, how did I get the opportunity? I asked him, give me somebody from the back. And if they beat me, they can have the opportunity on anniversary. You see, Jay, I was giving somebody an opportunity, something that champion hasn't done. But you know what he did? He didn't pick you. He didn't pick anyone. He picked himself. That son of a bitch picked himself. And you know what happened? I beat him. I beat him to earn my spot. But let's talk about, again, about handed opportunities. Jay, you have handed me that Internet Championship match at Ultimate Glory 5. And it's set. But prepare for what you wish for, because you're going to regret it. Because not only am I going to take away the Internet Championship from you, I'm going to shut you up. Not just you. Everyone that said the same crap for a year. And if I damn well pleased, I would take your bitch as well.
And ladies and gentlemen, we are back with Jay Krack and John Blackos, two amazing superstars. I don't blame Jay Krack for what happened with the Brandon Wolfe situation. Jay Krack came out, he was to pick a fight with Brandon Wolfe. This puts me in the opposite position because I'm very pro Wolfe fan, I'm very pro Jay Krack. My personal actions died, however, now. Together. I don't blame Jay Krack because y'all some great and clearly one of the top superstars in COH today at Jay Krack. The fans, everybody, he will be treated for a wonderful match when they finally hook up. But I do not blame Jay Krack for his role in that. And I have said that from day one.
Well, Doc, weren't you just saying earlier that you were questioning the Goonies' response to what happened?
That's not on Jay Krack. Jay Krack came out and laid out Brandon Wolfe. And my response, my whole thing from that with the beginning is the Goonie, an honorable champion, as he claimed to be, as the fans think that he is, an honorable champion would have stopped the match and chosen not to win. That is what an honorable champion such as the Goonie proclaiming to be, that is what an honorable champion would have done.
Well, I'll tell you what, speaking of honorable, more honorable than Jay Krack, more honorable than this conflicted personal state that John Blackos has found him in, siding himself with Jay Krack. I know he signed a contract and put it all on the line, but he still has something called morality that he has to look at every once in a while here. Even all of this with the Goonies, Brandon Wolfe knows what it means to be honorable here, and he is the wrong party in this. And if I'm on anybody's side in this matter, I'm on the Wolfman's side.
Wolfman! Ow, ow, ow! Ow, ow!
Well, I know you're a fan of this guy, Doc. V-Pac on his way out here.
I was about ready to say, the, you know, new COH look, same Sub-Zero look.
V-Pac's been on a come-upance here lately. He's been on the rise. A little bit on everybody's radar of late, it seems like. And he's definitely been making the rounds here in COH lately.
Including Brandon Wolfe. They've not been without some conflict recently. And tonight, they are going to be relying on each other if they want to win this match. I personally don't like Brandon Wolfe's chances of coming out of this match. Going against two able-bodied one-on-one, I always like Brandon Wolfe against John Blackos himself or Jay Krack himself. But I honestly think he'll be alone in this match because you just can't count on V-Pac right now.
Oh, Krack already tagging in Blackos here. This is going to let Blackos do the heavy lifting for him tonight. But Brandon Wolfe dropping Blackos there.
I tell you what, three of the men in this ring right now are some of the most talented individuals. And one would be a talented individual if he just manned up and admitted that he has a man crush on Sub-Zero. So, you know, John Blackos, the Human Energizer Bunny, Jay Krack, you know, and Brandon Wolfe, some of the top rising stars in Call. Well, Jay Krack, I've actually said, in many opinion at least, that they're the top rising stars. I've already said Brandon Wolfe's already there. He just hasn't been given that opportunity, because the stars have not completely aligned for him yet. And because Jay Krack, you would say that he did get that opportunity against Goonie, but Jay Krack clearly wanted to have a shot at Brandon Wolfe before he felt that he deserved that shot.
Yeah, you'd say it's been a hard road for Brandon Wolfe. You know, we've seen a lot of the early days of Brandon Wolfe we did in El Dorado Championship Wrestling before he went on to...
Where?
Yeah, you know, El Dorado Championship Wrestling, the... little mom and pop brand that you you so kindly plugged earlier.
Oh, the Pick Pack.
Oh yeah, you know. Then he went on to bigger stages such as COH here, and the rest of the
season. Much bigger stage.
But speaking of other individuals in this match, you know, our owner and operator Ryan Paul Jones himself, I must say, has had his eye on talent as well, such as Jay Krack and John Blackos, who just recently signed with ECW. So, you know, people are making their rounds, and we're aware of it as well. So, this is a big match here for all four of these men.
You know what the coolest thing about Ryan Paul Jones is? RPJ is a cool nickname to go by.
I'm sure the
boss. That's the only cool thing about Ryan Paul.
Well, I'll pass that along the next time.
You don't have to. I see him. He knows. I send him that on an email once a week.
Well, Doc, at least we have your support in that regard.
What regard? I email him. I don't say congratulations on running a successful franchise. I say this is the reminder that the only cool thing about you is the fact that you go by RPJ. That's it. And then I put, like, either a smiley face or a thumbs up or whatever emoji the emoji movie stops on when I press pause on it.
see here as we get back to the match.
Brandon Wolfe just freaking waylaid on John Blackos. FYI, that can still be a hate crime, Brandon.
Now, I was going to make mention here that it seems like every time Wolfe gets into the ring, J-Crack gets to the apron and passes the torch off here to Blackos to face the wrath of the Wolfman.
It's good strategy, too, because he knows that Brandon Wolfe is dying to get his hands on. And he is trying to just make Brandon Wolfe that much angrier. The fact that he knows that he can't get to him legally in this ring.
We've all seen the darker side of Brandon Wolfe, the Night Wolfe, as he calls it. And, J-Crack is a very intelligent superstar. And he knows he's been doing his best here to do what he does best and manipulating Brandon Wolfe, it would seem.
J-Crack not going to allow John Blackos to tag him in.
John is, I guess for lack of better terms, is an indentured servant, so he's going to let John, again, continue to carry the weight of this match.
That's racist. Indentured servant.
I'm just pointing out the obvious here, Doc.
Blackos, sure.
He did sign a contract in which
It's because he's French. He can't read English.
Oh, so now it's a nationality issue.
Yes, that's exactly what it is.
See, J-Crack here getting
Hail Fuhrer Trump.
Getting himself back into this match legally and trying to pick apart V-Pac after Blackos has done more of the work for him.
J-Crack taunting a little bit there, saying, get over here. That's got a rub in the crawl of Sub-Zero.
Ironically, he's wearing the yellow, so I guess
yes,
you do have a point there.
Yes. Get over here.
I think more importantly here, J-Crack is keeping V-Pac isolated from Brandon Wolfe. Again, J-Crack doing his best to stay away from Brandon Wolfe in this tag team affair.
You don't want no part of the Wolfman.
To your earlier point, Doc, here we're seeing this, that it looks like V-Pac and Brandon Wolfe had a little bit of early teamwork success, but now it's really Blackos and Krack just controlling the pacing of this matchup here.
Controlling the pace because the chemistry is just not there for V-Pac and Brandon Wolfe. And, you know, this is just really an unfortunate teaming for the Wolfman. Clearly the more talented superstar of this pairing. Whereas the two elite superstars with John Blackos and J-Crack, there's only one elite superstar in the other corner and a guy with an identity crisis.
If they got V-Pac isolated here, Blackos with the side pendulum backbreaker, and there's an elbow from J-Crack.
J-Crack going for the cover here. One, two.
Oh, Brandon Wolfe. The Wolfe in there quickly to break that up.
Ow, ow, ow!
Might be his one shot at getting his hands on J-Crack in this match here. Oh, wait a second. Crack with a big Falcon Arrow.
This match is clearly going the way of J-Crack. And John Blackos, I think that they are showing why, you know, yeah, sure, John Blackos was kind of forced, as you put it, in all seriousness, he was forced into this situation, but there's no denying that they're working very well together.
Yeah, I touched on that, you know, and I was shocked to see that Blackos so just quickly accepted what he had signed on for, and I mean, it's not reluctant at all. He's taking, you know, what has been handed to him, and I don't know, maybe he sees it as an opportunity to be paired with J-Crack here.
Well, I mean, there's also the fact that he's French and they're really good at surrendering.
That's questionable. I see your point there. History does play to that a little bit.
Yes, a little bit.
V-Pac, speaking of question, because V-Pac,
he finally got his hands on Jay Krack, and he just failed on him.
I didn't think V-Pac was going to make the tag there, but he did, and Brandon Wolfe coming in here like a house of fire, trying to burn the place down.
Good gosh! Punch after punch after punch to the face of Jay Krack. Jay Krack finding himself on the outside of the ring. Wow! What a quick turn of events that is now that these two men are in the ring together. Oh my God, that's concrete! Oh, but wait a minute, he chooses not to go on the concrete, but on the metal side of the ring.
Well, Brandon Wolfe laying into a huge jackknife powerbomb there on the ring apron. Jay Krack needs to go over to John Blackos. He's in a very dire position here.
And business just damn sure picked up. Goes to JR. Punch and another punch, another series of punches here. Jay Krack is in a predicament that he did not want to be in.
No, Brandon Wolfe. Oh my God. Missing that spear and driving himself into the floor there. All that momentum reversed. Now Jay Krack tagging Blackos back into this match, and Brandon Wolfe is feeling the effects. That spear definitely turning things around in a very bad way for him. Blackos here with an STF applied on the Wolfman.
And the Wolfman just had the wind taken out of his sails just momentarily, as you said.
That spear is so dangerous, even if you connect with it. When you miss, that's a proverbial suicide dive there to yourself, straight to the floor.
Yeah, you know what? Brandon Wolfe just got so caught up right there. So caught up. And now it looks like he's starting to get back on his feet. I know that they haven't really been working well together to try to find a way to get V-Pac in this ring. Or if he wants to have another shot at Jay Krack, at least tonight, it's in his best interest to extend this match as much as he can.
This has been kind of the ballad of Brandon Wolfe, if you will. He gets this red hot momentum, and sometimes he just loses control of things once he gets to that point. He almost loses sight. And it looks like there's a tag that he was needing. V-Pac getting wound up here. They did this earlier with Blackos, another one of those power bombs, a buckle bomb into the Enziguri head kick. Wait a second, V-Pac here. See this with V-Pac time and time again.
I feel like I'm a psychic. As soon as I said something, it happens.
V-Pac connecting with that running dropkick off the gut buster.
Do I have ESPN?
Depends on your cable package there, Doc. Wait, Brandon Wolfe getting his hands on Jay Krack again. All four men break.
What does cable have to do with a psychic ability?
You said ESPN.
That's what I'm saying, but I have ESPN. It's when people can read your mind.
I believe they call it ESP or telepathy.
I think you got hit on the head.
Well, Brandon Wolfe landed pretty close to the table, but he did not land in my lap, so I will refrain from fully acknowledging that statement. Blackos and V-Pac continue to lock up here. Wait, Blackos the face buster.
Probably made him prettier.
If it takes too many of those, he might have to go with the full Sub-Zero mask, Doc.
He like yes, he might. Could have a full force Maluna thing going on. Ugh. Can you imagine kissing Melina? The teeth that's got to be involved there.
Blackos, a pinfall, just a standing elbow drop. Yeah, that's nightmare material. Oh.
Like kissing a cactus. If a cactus had a tongue. And Melina were green.
Blackos.
John Blackos here setting up. What?
Oh my
God!
Butterfly pile driver. That's not it. Two, three, and he puts away V-Pac here. Brandon Wolfe is taken out. And look, Jay Krack just rubbing it in his face.
Nope. Once again, like I said, this is just one of those things where you know, we called it from the beginning. I said, I don't know how well they're going to work together. Now, the V-Pac and Brandon Wolfe did have a certain amount of chemistry, but in the end, like you brought out, like you pointed out, Blackos and Jay Krack have just gelled. And they just work together so well.
Yeah, it's almost, you know, in a very odd way that Jay Krack has honed the talent of John Blackos that, you know, people like yourself, Doc, have pointed out for a while now that John Blackos, he has that something within him, but yeah, Jay Krack seems up right here, brought it out of him, picking up the victory for himself and Krack.
And something else to note, to Krack's credit, you let Blackos get the tag. We've seen several times in the past where similar situations to these two, the aggressor or the owner goes forward and tries to push them out of the way. He let Blackos get that victory.
And look at this, Doc. He raised the arm of Jay Krack as if Jay was the one who took the pin here tonight.
It's just a remarkable tandem.
Oh, look at this. Holding the rope for him.
I tell you what, it's like a forced love story of Beauty and the Beast.
That's definitely a very awkward. I don't know how to describe it. Really, a very interesting dichotomy between these two.
They put their bodies, their careers, and their lives on the line. They have spent years training and have a lifetime of experience. But what entertains you tears their bodies apart. So cheer for them, admire them, believe in them, but leave the action to them. Please do not try this at home.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are back here. Ready to go back into action again. Frankenstein is making his way down to the rear. What's that? Not Frankenstein? Hold on, breaking news.
It's hard to see with all of this sparkling effects here, sparkler pyrotechnic, and
the Grim
Reaper.
It is one of my personal heroes, Daniel Mars, the DM, on his way down to the ring.
Well, Daniel Mars, dating back to when I first started watching COH, you want to talk about a transformation in character. This guy has been on quite the roller coaster here, and it seems like the man that conducted that train largely for Daniel Mars was his former mentor, I guess you could say, inspiration, him, accuracy.
And you know, I agree with you, but I like to think I also had something to do with that as well.
Well, I know Daniel Mars, from what I've seen around the web, he does cite you, Doc, as an inspiration as well.
I mean, I was one of the ones that picked up the fact that he was trying to figure out his spot in the early eradication. Sure, inaccuracy included in him in the group, but he never really had that identity. And he reached out and became, watching him transform, we witnessed it.
Ever since Anniversary, I've really started to understand how a change can really affect someone. I can sit here in a chair and talk about mind games, but I realize something. You people, you love to be entertained, you love to have a good time. And I feel as if the role I once had now belongs to someone else. Someone I kicked in the head. But that's okay. It's okay that Immaculacy wants to please you people. He says he's a crazy fuck. No. He's an entertainer. But I'm gonna tell you some realness. A real truth, if you will. Let's go back further than Anniversary. The very first person drafted in the COH draft was me. The very first. Yes, I'm part of the eradication. Yes, I'll admit, I do not have my tag team championships. Lost them fair and square. But here's a question. My leader, Hypocrites, what has he won? Serious. What has Hypocrites done this season other than put this group together, get manipulated, because he lost at manipulating people? Normally, he makes the first big move. But no, that's me. I beat him to that. He has been beaten. He has been broken time after time by person after person. Who won for the eradication inside an elimination chamber? Daniel Mars did. Who couldn't even bring gold home to the eradication? It sure wasn't Hypocrites. It was Daniel Mars and GM. So, the thing that just, it leaves me like Hypocrites is nothing more than a shell of a man, is that ever since Anniversary, he has yet to step foot in this ring and compete. But, when I get off, when I'm finishing the ring, whipping ass, doing what you guys know I can do, everybody knows what I can do, I go on the back, and there's constant criticism, there's constant laughter, there's constant humor, because all Hypocrites can do is make a joke, post a meme on Facebook. That's not the sick fuck that attracted me to want guidance. That isn't the sick fuck that I know is a successful competitor in COH. No, that's a parody. So I want everybody here to realize, I invite Hypocrites to compete tonight, and if he can't, then he proves a point as to why he got kicked in the head. That maybe he truly is nothing more than a parody of his old self, and that the real joke going around this locker room, around the world, isn't him making fun of me. It's knowing that he is the joke. And if he keeps this up, the joke's gonna be on him when he gets beat down again.
Some strong words indeed about to be answered. This means that the funarchist himself is on his way out.
Well, if this is about to go the way that I think it is, I think the joke is going to be on your man, Daniel Mars, tonight.
Hypocrisy, struggling with normality. Nonetheless, the funarchist himself has arrived.
Is there any truth, any merit to what Daniel Mars has said? You think that Hypocrisy has lost his footing here in COH?
I do, to an extent. And it took me a minute to answer that, because truly it can go either way, but I think he has. And the reason being, and if I get cut off, I'll resume this thought. The reason being is he used to be unpredictable. He used to have that essence. And I know he's contested before that the commentators, we were wrong, you know, we, myself and Oliver, we were wrong in relatively calling him normal, but really look at it. What would the old Hypocrisy come out dressed as? He'd come out looking like Pennywise, and...
Okay, yeah, you're done babbling, right? You're done with the constant drivelling on about how you looked up to me and you kicked me in the face, blah, 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 blah. Okay, we get it. You got one up on me, and you pretty much have nothing to back up all the jokes that I put on you. Quite frankly, I don't need to make a joke, because all you gotta do is look in the mirror. You will see the funniest joke in the world. I don't have to do Meemarkey. I only do Meemarkey just because of how pathetic you really are and how I need to make this between us entertaining. Because everybody knows I could just take you in the ring, beat the ever-loving piss out of you, and mentally scar you for life and put you into permanent anguish. But you know what? Seeing as you really want to see what I can do in the ring, I'll bite. I'll face any opponent that you see me having to go up against. And if you have anybody of any stature that could step up to the Funarchist himself, then maybe for once I could pat you upside the head and say, good job, you actually accomplished something for once. But I don't see it happening because, Daniel, let's just face facts. All this get-up is all because while your mother was pregnant with you, she stuck a coat hanger in the womb inside your head. And now you've become this disgusting waste. And quite frankly, we would be much better off if you went exactly there, the wayside. But you know what? Like I said, bring out your opponent. I'll face anybody you wish. I'm ready to go.
Wrong words there. And see, this is what I mean. It's predictable. We've seen this. Wow.
Oh my god. This is what I was...
Wow.
Not to cut you off there, Doc. I apologize, but this is what I was just getting ready to say. When you say something like, and I quote, I will face whoever you have, this is the kind of trouble and the kind of fight you find yourself up against.
And you know, we've seen this before. This is what I'm talking about when I... Yeah, it took me a minute to answer whether or not Inaccuracy has lost his footing, but how predictable is this? How mundane? How many times in the last few months have we seen, oh, he's picking an opponent and I'll beat them? These open challenges, these run-of-the-mill, yeah, they're supposed to be surprises, but we've been using them way too much lately. So to that, I say yes, Inaccuracy slightly has lost his footing, maybe not completely, because he's still a very skilled superstar. And as we saw earlier, he kicked the boss in the head, but I saw that coming a mile away. But
I was gonna point out there, you know, the thing that
if you have a GPA above a 1.5 and an IQ above a 10, then you probably maybe were surprised by that. Everyone else
I was going to point out, you know, this is, it seems like it's been a running thing going back to Phoenix and Nitro. Daniel Mars trying to get his chosen opponent here back into things, but you know, manipulation, mind games has been a running theme here, and it seems that like Inaccuracy may be playing into what Daniel Mars has in mind for him a little bit here.
And you know what? I think that may be the case. I don't like this move by Inaccuracy just because, like I said, it's been overplayed. But, you know, Stefan Guerrero, a dangerous opponent, as I found out firsthand. But Stefan Guerrero is not the guy that frankly, you want to be fighting in an open challenge. Because this guy will mess you up. This guy will hurt you. And Inaccuracy clearly does not realize that, or is confident enough that he can mess him up first.
Well, Inaccuracy, as we all know, it can be a glutton for punishment, has probably one of the highest pain thresholds in COH. But Stefan Guerrero, it's well documented, the physical damage that he can bestow on an opponent, the physicality that he brings to the ring, and you have Daniel Mars out here ringside just observing all of this, taking mental notes, watching what he can do later, possibly, to break down inaccuracy here. Because we all know that Stefan Guerrero is the type of man who knows how to take an opponent apart limb by limb.
And that's probably right there why Daniel Marsh selected him, because he can do that. He does have that ability. And that does make him dangerous. You know, he's a fighter. He's a technician. And that's what those do, especially with that Peruvian strong style. You know, he doesn't just get you where it hurts. He picks you apart and makes you hurt more.
Oh, yeah. He's the type of man, he enjoys making people hurt. A little bit of a similarity there between he and inaccuracy. Inaccuracy starting to turn things around here and getting fired up after that knife edge chop sweeping Guerrero off of his vertical base there. But there's a knee lift, and Guerrero trying to get right back into the offense himself. What a right hand that was.
These two, this is going to make him, this would be a pay-per-view quality match any other day of the week. And tonight we're getting it on Battleground because of an open challenge inaccuracy and issued for himself, really, and Daniel Marsh kind of stepped up to that.
Yeah, you know, as soon as I heard the music hit, that was my immediate reaction. Wow, this is pay-per-view quality, or CPU quality here, excuse me, and on Battleground. Who knew? Anything can happen here on Battleground. Accuracy there with a counter, trying to put the chin breaker. Getting into a little bit of a striking contest here with the Peruvian strong style specialist. Back elbow takes Guerrero off of his feet and into the cover.
One, two, two count. Stefan kicks out.
Inaccuracy here in a verbal debate with the referee. Not the smartest thing. He needs to keep his head about him as much as he can. You know, it can be challenging for the likes of inaccuracy, but he's really got to try to stay on top of Guerrero. He doesn't want to falter here with Daniel Mars watching close by. It's like a Guerrero toss right out here in front of us, Doc.
Guerrero knows that I've made his life. He beat me, but he knows that I've made his life a living hell. And I mean, the reason he's no longer the internet champion because of the mark I put on him. So he knows to stay far away from me.
Inaccuracy here. Suicide dive, taking Guerrero out.
Stefan just now starting to move flat on his back for a while. Inaccuracy really has the upper hand now, you know. Literally was on the upper hand right there.
Yeah. driving the double axe handle there, almost to the shoulder blades in the back of the neck. You know, you see one connecting there, usually lands right flush on top of the head. But that's that unorthodox style that inaccuracy brings to the table.
Daniel Mars has not moved.
And he's just got
He's stayed very still.
He's got this almost stoic expression here as he just studies inaccuracy.
Stefan Guerrero setting him up. Papano showing neck. Off a little bit of that Peruvian strong style.
Yeah, that Papano neck breaker connects, and a little bit of a disbelief here that the referee didn't make the three count on that one, but inaccuracy, again, the resilience to kick out.
Like some of our referees got the three. You serious?
I would hope so if that's their primary employment, Doc, but
they count one, two, and one again. So they do. Simpletons.
Hey, they're some of the hardest working men here in COH. You gotta give these guys a break.
Wow, what an open-handed smack. A slap. Yeah. What humiliation.
Yeah, it's Guerrero now. That power again, power bomb right into the turnbuckle, and Daniel Mars applauding him for that one.
Stefan Guerrero has one objective here per Daniel Mars, to inflict as much pain as possible and maybe to beat inaccuracy in his own inflicted open challenge.
You gotta think here too, this is a big step up for Stefan Guerrero. He's fought some big names in the past, but a win over Immaculacy, this is a definitive moment here, should he succeed in this mission handed out to him here by Daniel Mars.
Yeah, I think that I think you're right. I think that, you know, whether he wins or loses here, I think he's done himself a favor already by hanging in like this and really having the upper hand for most of the match. Not only just hanging in, but like you said, having the upper hand against an opponent the quality of Immaculacy.
Immaculacy's got a hand on the rope there. Referee almost didn't see it. I was just going to point out at that last pinfall attempt there that Immaculacy was within range of the ropes, but he was able to kick out. That time he grabbed the ropes and almost an error there on the referee's part, but still managed to kick out nonetheless. Guerrero putting himself between the ropes this time off that drop kick. And getting a little bit of frustration now on Guerrero. Cannot put away Immaculacy as quickly as he once thought that he could. Going for the pin here again. Oh, no, he's got his feet on the ropes.
Oh, yeah. He's using those ropes.
Wait a second. Oh.
Two count. Immaculacy kicking out. Even as Stefan tries to even the score a little bit.
They thought he had Immaculacy's number with that one. Immaculacy still kicking out. Tilt the world neck breaker there. Makes the cover again. And still.
Couple times in a row that the master of Peruvian strong style, Stefan Guerrero, has tried to end the matchup, but to no avail. Immaculacy is going to keep swinging, it seems.
Look at this, another pinfall attempt here. Oh, this one even a one count, not even the two count this time.
Like, how embarrassed is that? Let's talk about that for a second. A one count. Jeez.
Guerrero here, look at this. Oh, trying to stretch him out now. The pins aren't working. Going straight for a submission, it would appear. It might be even harder to get Immaculacy to submit, though.
Yeah, he seems to like that pin.
Roll through there, big clothesline. Guerrero goes to the outside.
Both of them, I'm sure Immaculacy did not anticipate this match running this length, but he also didn't expect to see Stefan Guerrero answer that challenge either.
Oh, wait a second. Funarchy driver. Funarchy driver connects in the middle of the ring. Seemingly out of nowhere, Stefan Guerrero gets spiked right on his
head.
What
a hit.
Some vintage Immaculacy here on Battleground. Oh my, go away.
Two count there. Stefan Guerrero's not done yet.
Rolling the shoulder up. Immaculacy. There's a nice kip up there. Oh, the Manhattan drop. And a big scoop slam.
What a punch to the face.
And a backstabber. Knees straight to the kidney lower back there. Stefan Guerrero. Oh, Guerrero with a quick kick out himself.
Immaculacy is getting to the point where he did not believe that. He couldn't believe it.
Oh, wait a second. Looking for the arrogance kick here. No. Guerrero. Hammering away. This is a snapmare takedown. Oh, but Immaculacy right back to his feet. Oh, Guerrero misses the rolling elbow. Back and forth, and oh, Immaculacy dumped to the outside.
Stefan Guerrero. Wait a second here.
The GM is here. Immaculacy turning his attention to the GM. Oh, oh my, oh. He caught it with a kick.
He ran right into it.
Arrogance kick. The GM is down.
All that momentum coming straight for Immaculacy, and he ran right into the kick.
Oh, wait,
ran right into the...
Oh, Guerrero taking advantage. Oh, and there's the rolling elbow that time. Connects.
One, two, and three. Wow. Wow, what a pickup win there by Stefan Guerrero.
Putting away inaccuracy with a little bit of assistance from the Eradication's GM.
I disagree completely. He didn't lay a finger on inaccuracy.
You gotta think though, inaccuracy was setting up for that arrogance kick otherwise.
And we are back. It appears Kenyon Phoenix is making his way to the ring.
Well, I guess we're going to get our answer. The question, the burning question of the evening here, Doc. Are we going to have the main event that Kenyon Phoenix has requested?
I'm going to hope not, but somehow I think, you know, we're going to have it. But I would hope that the ultimate one would be smarter than that.
Yeah, again, I cannot reiterate it enough. He, as in the ultimate one, has so much to lose here. Who doesn't want to see the ultimate one and the Goonie at ultimate glory? It just sounds like a marquee, a main event matchup. On the other hand, we have this man who comes out here and instigates and provokes Nitro just beyond belief.
Because who wants to see Phoenix versus Goonie 20? Nobody wants to see that.
I'll tell you what, I definitely don't want to see a man who comes out here and throws every excuse possible at the Ultimate Win for why he lost a battle royal that he himself again stated wasn't even that important of a match, and now feels that, oh, he should just be handed the title shot in place of the Ultimate One.
It's because Phoenix believes the words that he spouts out that he just makes at random. He could say, the sky is purple, and he would believe it as the Ultimate One. I gotta say, this looks like ring gear for the Ultimate One.
Yeah, he's got a that fire, you can see it in his eyes. 1,000-yard stare here for Phoenix. I have a bad feeling about this guy. I just don't see this ending well for the Ultimate One.
I agree. Whenever you put pride before your mission, bad things will happen. And I've been very pro the Ultimate One, and he's on a doctor's order contract in another bed, you know, closely together. I do not agree with this decision. And I wish he had consulted me further about this.
Wait a second here.
Like I said, he was in ring gear. Yeah, we got an answer here.
Yeah, we got a referee calling for the bell. We officially have this main event.
I can't believe that. I cannot believe that the Ultimate One is not smarter to see right through this. I will be having a discussion with him later.
Well, we already saw what happened in our last match here. Inaccuracy taking his eyes off the prize. Nitro needs to think twice here. Oh, my. Oh, he got dropkicked. Yeah. As soon as he went up there to match Phoenix with that showboating.
Phoenix was taunting, and Nitro Truck, same thing. It did not work out.
He's got to be very, very careful here, very observant not to play right into the trap that Phoenix is trying to set for him.
I just hope that he hasn't already played into that trap.
I'm very fearful here for what could happen. And Phoenix, these vicious strikes of Nitro. Throwing him
what
from
a
the turnbuckle.
Power.
Yeah, throwing him straight off his base there from the turnbuckle. Up and over. Holds on to the apron here. Oh!
Oh, wow. Nitro not quite connecting with that medium risk maneuver there.
Yeah, you gotta think that missing, landing on the leg like that's gonna leave a big bullseye there on the knee for Phoenix to take advantage of should he choose to. Oh, wait. Oh, what a face buster. Their innovative offense from Kenyon Phoenix.
Two count.
An early two count. Nitro really needs to be careful here. Things are quickly playing into the favor of Phoenix.
Indeed they are. Phoenix on the offensive quickly. And with that, Nitro has no green health left.
A scaling. Oh my god. Shooting star with a corkscrew almost there. Kenyon Phoenix quickly in the driver's seat here. Another two count.
Fireman's carry over there. Yes.
Doc, I've got to ask you the question here. Who does it favor if you're Goonie going into Ultimate Glory? Do you want Nitro or do you want Phoenix? You said he's very, very experienced with Phoenix in the ring.
I want Phoenix because if you get Phoenix, you know what you're going to get. With Nitro, you know he's hungry. You know he's got things to prove. You don't want to go. You don't want any part of that, especially when you've just been questioned by Phoenix. So if Phoenix loses this match, that's going to add more fuel to the fire for the Ultimate One, and you do not want to run into that buzzsaw. And, you know, obviously if that were to happen, I would be working with Nitro day-to-day basis, getting him ready for that match, getting him more ready mentally. But right now, it favors, you want Phoenix. Your favorite to win this match if you're a Goonie is Phoenix.
Phoenix here running through Nitro there with that combination of strikes. This is a very calculating and very sinister almost Kenyon Phoenix like I've never seen before, just really taking apart Nitro, dominating this match almost at this point.
I think when he got stabbed by Inaccuracy, it might have like left an infection in him.
Oh,
he just hasn't quite ever gotten over it. Oh my gosh, what a DDT.
On the outside of the ring here, very little padding there on the outside between the floor. Nitro might be out of this. He needs to get back in the ring. Well, how humiliating would it be to take the count out here as Phoenix is just laughing at him.
He told him a joke. He was just laughing at his joke.
Nitro here getting trapped in the ropes now. Nitro has got to figure out something here to stop this barrage of offense. Two count.
Well, two count there. Dangerously close.
I think the only
if
thing
you're the Ultimate One.
The only thing that saved the Ultimate One there, Phoenix may not have had enough leverage across the shoulders and allowed Nitro to get up, and there's a rolling elbow. Taking a play out of his a former rival or Fun Guerrero's playbook. Oh, wait a second, Nitro. Nitro, oh, Phoenix trying to recover, but Nitro, full head of steam here, looking for the suicide. Oh my, into a DDT.
Wow. Nitro, the Ultimate One, showing right there why he is the Ultimate One.
A huge risk and a huge payoff there. Spiking Phoenix, and there's a leaping Russian leg sweep. And now it's Phoenix who's on the opposite side of this 10 count. He needs to get back into the ring. He's crawling the wrong way.
He is indeed. I was laughing. The Ultimate One shaking it loose a little bit there.
Up against the ropes here. Nitro's got something in mind. Hangs him out to dry on the top rope. For a man who previously, like you had pointed out, been stabbed in the abdomen, that's not going to feel good. Nitro diving elbow drop. Going to the top again, but Phoenix is back up. He's going to meet him.
Oh,
and he hangs him out to dry on the turnbuckle.
The little Nitros are going to be in some pain.
Here we go, Kenyon Phoenix. Big overhead Pele kick. Phoenix, maybe a Phoenix splash here. From oh my god, a 450 instead.
Kenyon Phoenix just pulled off a 450 on the Ultimate One.
And Nitro able to get out at a very close two count yet again. Phoenix here, roll through, schoolboy, super kick connects. No.
Count. Phoenix has got to be thinking, all right, now, what do I got to do?
Yeah, he can't allow himself to get frustrated now. Oh! Hooks the leg deep here. Another two count.
One. Two. Two count, not quite a three. Phoenix still driving in the chair, in the driving chair here.
Yeah, it looks. You can see the look on his face there. He was kind of hesitated to get up, looked a little lost for words as Nitro just will not stay down.
Because he's the Ultimate One.
Oh, Nitro, wait a second, kicks his leg off from underneath it. There's a shining wizard.
Good night. Phoenix, bust it open now.
Yeah, Doc, it looks like both men, maybe that super kick earlier might have caught Nitro and perforated him a little. Both of these men got some blood trickling down the forehead there.
Like a warrior, the Ultimate One does.
This thing got very, very personal earlier, beginning of tonight's show, and it's getting ugly now. And there's another super kick from Phoenix. Oh, look at this referee. Every forcing Phoenix to back up here. Nitro could be hurt.
Nitro not moving. Like you said, he very well could be.
Referee asking if he wants to continue. But wait a second. Phoenix is trying to steal this thing.
What? Wait a minute.
Oh, no. Not
wait
like this.
A minute.
Not like this. Oh.
Indeed. Phoenix seemed to be trying to pick up a quick one there.
That was too close for comfort. Nitro, wait a second. Oh! He connects. Two count. And oh, no.
Oh, the Ultimate One. So close to a three count there.
Yeah, maybe a millisecond there from putting this thing to rest here.
Phoenix. He's got to be... He's got to be tasting it right now. He's got to be thinking, what am I going to do once I shut Kenyon Phoenix up?
You can see the look here. He's just stretching Phoenix out off that pendulum backbreaker. Phoenix, though. Oh. The longer this match goes, these strikes just throwing with more malicious intent from both men. Oh, it rolls him through again. Look for number three here. Another super kick.
Phoenix here. Holding the ropes again.
Oh, no.
But wait a minute.
No.
Wait a minute. Wait, what did we just witness?
It didn't work the first time, but it worked that time, and I'm just shocked the referee didn't see it this time. The referee should have done something about this. This is a travesty is what this is, Doc.
Not like this. The Ultimate One cannot simply lose like this. This has to be reviewed.
Somebody.
Phoenix using his feet on the ropes illegally.
Yeah, somebody needs to be on the phone with Mr. Sparks about this. This is not how you set the stage for an Ultimate Glory championship match, a global championship match.
Especially one that's already marred in controversy just because the Goonies are champion.
I'm just disgusted by this. I don't even know what to say.
This has to be reviewed. We have to talk about this. This can't be how it ends for the Ultimate One's crusade. It can't be how it ends. Ladies and gentlemen, for Brian Cole, welcome to the booth with me, brother. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the Doc. Nitro putting himself out there.
This is a heartbreaking conclusion to tonight's Battleground. And Doc, thank you for having me here tonight.
Thank you for joining us, ladies and gentlemen. We'll see you on the next edition of Battleground. And we're going to have a lot to talk about at that point. I can't guarantee you. Good night, everybody.